that's really positive stuff. And obviously, we've all had to come back in perhaps a few months' time just to give us an update in that respect.
Always happy to come back, Lee.
Okay then, moving on then, and moving very nicely on, item 5 is improving the bus offer for the Liverpool City Region, and Matt's going to give us the update on the alliance.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks Howard for not talking too much about what I'm going to talk about. Obviously there is a little bit of, repetition. I'm presenting 3 reports actually today, so I'll spend a little bit longer on this one. 12 months since we were sat in this room and the committee approved both the bus strategy but also gave us the go ahead to progress the alliance to a formal status. So, as such, we wanted to update you all on the progress we made, specifically on the alliance, but also including against our headline targets around customer satisfaction and fair pay patronage growth, as well as giving you a little bit of a taste of what's to come as well in our plans over the next 12 months. Also use the opportunity just to give you a very brief update on the bus services bill and our work in relation to that. The report acts as our regular quarterly update on the alliance to the committee as well, which is one of the commitments that we have. And the contents as well of this report are going to be used to update April's combined authority meeting as well on progress on the alliance. You remember key elements of the bus strategy, which were to outline firstly the importance of bus to the Liverpool City region, and I think that's now very well understood, things like the importance to the economy and to society, some of the issues and opportunities for bus, and also our ambitions and our vision for bus services into the future. And the alliance was formed with a view to bringing some of that to our mission to life. We outlined our ambition to increase fair pay patronage by 10% and deliver industry-leading customer satisfaction scores over 3 years. And we decided that 3 years was going to include the kind of the pre-alliance period where we've done some good work together. You also remember we enshrined these aims in along with other targets and milestones in a voluntary partnership arrangement, which we signed back in September last year. So the main content of the report's from kind of page 10 onwards. So what we've done is break down some of the kind of key achievements in each of the 6 work streams that we have in the alliance, and also some of the plans that we have. So I'll briefly take each one of those work streams in turn. So start with network design. That's been heavily focused on the network reviews, which we talked about in the previous presentation, about making the network clearer and simpler to understand, as well as being a mechanism for us to be able to reduce the cost of supporting bus services. We've delivered those reviews in Kirby and St Helens. Later also we've been working for over 18 months now with operators and Liverpool City Council and bus routing strategy for the city centre. A lot of that kind of theoretical strategic work has now been completed, and we'll start over the next 12 to 18 months to move into more of a delivery phase of that strategy. Next, in terms of growth, I think most of the work in this particular work stream has been completed in the background, really, with a focus on kind of delivering some real tangible stuff in 2017-18, and we're just really just on the cusp of that now. The focus in this area is going to be on a joint engagement and marketing campaign, which has the overall kind of headline of Better by Bus. We're really excited about this, and I really think it's an industry-leading approach. No one else in the bus industry is doing anything like Better by Bus, where we're all getting together under one kind of common identity. We're using real-life young people as the kind of central points of this campaign. We're filming our first kind of video, which is supporting the campaign this weekend. And we had kind of X Factor style auditions involving young people a couple of weeks ago, where we literally had hundreds of young people who kind of turned up wanting to be part of that. So we're really excited about what that's going to show. We'll start to see some of that in the next few weeks. Also working with media partners such as the Liverpool Echo on how we can kind of engage willing audiences to try and change behaviours and attitudes towards the bus as well, which is kind of it's a longer term thing, but really crucial. Also going to schools, providing education materials which link back to the message around bus as well, along with kind of more traditional marketing and advertising type activity around the things that we're doing within the Alliance, so for example, ticketing. So I encourage you all to have a look at the Better by Bus website, which is kind of the hub for all of that activity. And also if you get a chance to kind of promote things via social media, etc., then that would encourage that. Next, in terms of punctuality and reliability, again, much has been happening kind of more in the background on this. We're really working with operators to deliver a better evidence base, put plans and structures in place to bring focus on areas where we really want to make an impactful and tangible improvement to people's journeys, in particular in terms of punctuality, with a real view to delivering from this year and beyond. We've submitted 7 schemes into the local growth fund bid, and we're also starting work on what the next 10 schemes might look like as well. So we've always got our kind of pipeline of things that we want to do in respect of punctuality and reliability. We're trialling a more advanced traffic signal system that kind of talks to the real-time information of buses, as well as rolling out more signal priority as well at their junctions. But despite the fact that we've been doing a lot of work in the background, we have still been delivering schemes out there on the network, actually 8 schemes in the city region over the last year, which have been focused on improving punctuality and reliability. Next, customer experience off the bus. This is where Merseytravel's 2016-17 capital programme has been largely focused, the highlight of which has been the new Kirby bus station, a big investment by Merseytravel in that town, and has been really well received. But we've also been delivering lots of smaller scale schemes to improve things like interchange points and other facilities. We're just completing some really significant investment on the Wirral at West Kirby and in Liscard, which will both be open in the next few weeks. We're partway through a process to replace all of our bus stop flags to give better kind of information and better confidence to people using the bus network, and also give a better identity to that network. Real-time information has been mentioned. I'm going to cover it in a second in a little bit more detail in another report, but our focus is really on improving the accuracy and availability of real-time information. It's still too low, it's not where it needs to be. And also one of our focuses now is going to be delivering our aspirations, so deliver more point of contact for customers. Customer experience on the bus has been really focused on, as Howard touched on fleet investment, bringing down fleet ages, enhancing the onboard experience. I think you started to see the fruits of that now on the road. If you stand out at Mann Island and you did the same thing 12 months ago, the profile of the buses you'll see passing you is completely different in that 12 months. By the end of 2017-18, we should have seen over £40 million of investment in new buses in the two years of the Alliance, which is great news for bus passengers. We supported that through the OLEV bid, which was the biggest award outside of London, and that's helped to introduce the hybrids that we've seen, and also, again, what Howard talked about, the electric and bio-relay buses that will come forward shortly. And those will really help to kind of directly impact on some of those air quality issues. From January last year, a new bus has free Wi-Fi and USB charging, and that's been retrofitted across fleets. We're also now from January delivering the new customer service training for drivers that Howard talked about, using real life examples to kind of talk through with drivers and getting them to kind of understand our customers. And it's really gone down the stall with drivers, and we're looking forward to delivering that to over 1,000 drivers by the end of this year. And finally, in terms of workstream ticketing, we've achieved our aim of making WAR as the smart car platform for bus, multi-operated bus and multimodal. Smart ticketing in the city region, that's been with good cooperation from operators. So, and that also enables us to market the platform as well as the tickets that are on it. In terms of those tickets, we've got the first set of operator weekly tickets on that platform with more to follow. As of this week, we've scrapped the zonal-based fare structure for solo tickets, so we've now got a much simpler solo offer where people can kind of better compare their different options. For some customers using annual tickets, that's led to a fare cut of over £260 a year, which is real good news for those people. I've also introduced a day solo, which should mean that people pay no more than £4.70 for a day's bus travel in the city in Merseyside, regardless of whatever operator. And as just been mentioned, we're working on a carnet version of that. As well as that, operators will be introducing contactless payment on bus this year. And all of that's, of course, on top of the fantastic My Ticket, which we've talked about, which continues to be one of the best young person tickets around. So that's some of the work that we've been doing and we've got planned. In terms of going back to those original targets around fair paying passengers and customer satisfaction, we've now got kind of the first results of these, which have already been touched on. We had a 3-year target to increase fare paying passengers by 10%, and we've reached in 2 years 9.7%, and we expect to kind of really bust that target over the third year. It's a real trend busting target and a real trend busting kind of delivery. Very few areas in the UK are seeing that sort of patronage growth, or indeed any patronage growth. So we're really, really pleased with that. I mentioned a few weeks ago, brief members on the Transport Foulkes bus survey results in some detail. Again, just as a reminder, we've increased customer satisfaction to 90%, and that's a real good result in things like driver interaction and value for money. But we're not yet best in class, so we've got some room for improvement there. Now, finally, on the bus services bill, we're waiting for this to become law in the next few weeks. We've been working closely, as mentioned before, with the FT and also with other regions to ensure the bill's as usable as possible. I think we've achieved quite a lot through a kind of a constructive approach particularly with the DFT, and we'll continue to work with them as they develop the guidance and regulations which will go with the bill. We've responded recently to a consultation in that respect. We also discussed a year ago, we've been looking at all of the options that the bill presented the city region in the form of a business case. That work started back in January, and we anticipate bringing forward the first kind of formal piece of work around that, which will be a strategic outline programme in the next kind of couple of months. questions on that report, and I know if there are any kind of further questions for operators as well, but if they didn't have it here from the station, I'm sure you through a large amount of work that's gone on in the last 18 months, 2 years. It's phenomenal the amount of work that's been done by a small number of people and the quality of work that's coming out. I mean, you know, I would like to admit it. My personal admiration for the work that they did in support of the active members, and particularly in support of myself. Not only was recognised for the work they did, but the work is seen out there by the general public, the mighty. Bus stops and the improvements of Cllr bus station, the people that really need to be working. These people do. They come for us as respected members to present. So I would like to go on record my admiration and say no to the man and my personal thanks.
Absolutely. Good.
So, first on the range of products, absolutely valid point there. I think one of the challenges around that has been there's been kind of so many products. How do you kind of communicate all of that? That's one of the reasons for addressing the solo issue and the different areas. Just by doing that, we cut out something like 40 different ticket variations just by removing the area, and moving to kind of one area. So by doing that sort of thing, by simplifying the amount of tickets that are out there, actually one of the things it does is it enables you to be able to communicate what's there better to customers, because otherwise you're kind of looking for a needle in a haystack because you've got such a volume. So I think we're not there yet, but I think we're making progress to kind of reduce the number of different types of tickets. And we've always got to think when we're putting new tickets out there, is that crowding the market too much? It's a bit of a judgment call to make, and that's kind of one of the arguments you might express around things like short haul fares, for example. Just on investment as well, I think Howard indicated we'll be up for doing more bids around low emission vehicles. similar rounds of funding available from DFT around that. So as soon as we have kind of more information about any potential funding, we'll be straight on the phone to have to talk about it. Survey. It's a standard survey that kind of applies right across the UK. It enables us to kind of benchmark ourselves with other areas and enables operators to do the same. That said, there is scope to influence what's in there, and I think we're fairly surely going to have those conversations with transport folks about what the next survey looks like. And we've also got the opportunity to kind of boost surveys as well and kind of add extra questions in. So that's something that I can assure you will take away as part of our discussion with Transport Focus for the September survey.
Just on the back of that point, before I bring John in, obviously Supreme Court judgments, clear in one way but unclear in lots of other ways. And my understanding is the difference of operating groups are going away to formulate whatever their kind of corporate policy responses are. Is it something under the terms of the alliance we could come up with a Liverpool City Region answer to, and almost have a kind of one joined up kind of policy as to how we deal with wheelchairs and buggies for people travelling on buses in the City Region? Because I think that's probably a more joined up approach rather than having a slightly different approach between different bus companies.
Yeah, I think if Liverpool City Region was going to be
no further questions or comments. Can I move the recommendations in paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed?
Agreed.
Excellent. And item 6 is the bus infrastructure policy in Carol's presentation. Says, and we hope you are.
I am.
Matt's doing it.
You can do it if you want. Yes, me again, sorry. and the next time as well. I'll be a little bit brief, as I just mentioned, on this one. We've discussed in workshops the bus infrastructure policy. So what we're asking members to do today is endorse a new policy around the provision of bus infrastructure. We're bringing this forward as one of the commitments in the bus strategy to do this as well. What we're trying to do is provide a better framework for what we do and why, and give some operational guidance as well around the topic. The policy focuses on the bus stop infrastructure that we deploy, which ranges from a simple kind of roadside post and bus station. Without reading everything out and going through it in detail, I just wanted to kind of pick out a few of the key elements. I think the policy will help us to make appropriate financial decisions around bus infrastructure, help to develop a better asset management plan around that. And I think that's particularly important given the financial challenges that the organisation has and needs to operate within. One example of that is that we've got, out of 6,100 bus stops, we've got 2,600 shelters. Given that shelters have a lifespan of 15 years, we need to plan longer term for how we replace these over time so that we're doing it in a managed and sustainable way. Policy also outlines how we kind of practically approach the renewal or removal or upgrade of bus stops, in particular the engagement process that we go through so that we take into account local views. We recognise the importance of accessibility within the policy, particularly in respect of shelter design and step-free access to buses, and also drop curbs at crossings, and all these being things that we want to make sure are captured and are being taken into account of in the future. Finally, we've got a guiding matrix of the types of facilities that we would like to see in respect of the numbers of boarders at those locations. So what would be expected at a stop, a shelter, or a bus station. That won't fit perfectly everywhere, but what we want it to do is to kind of help guide the decisions about where we invested in future and aid decisions that we're going to need to make. So I'm happy to take any questions on the policy.
Any questions or comments? Reasonably straightforward. We now move the recommendation of paragraph 2 of the report. It's agreed. Excellent. Item 7, real-time information policy. Matt, again.
For the last time. again, asking members to endorse a new policy, this time around real-time information. That topic was also discussed and covered in some detail at a previous members' workshop. And also bringing this forward again, a commitment in the bus strategy. You'll know we've had real-time information in one form or another for over 20 years in the city region. Current systems work together to present real-time information on screens and bus stops and on things like smartphones and on the web. So the policy is intended to give us a way forward in that respect, and again, help to guide our decisions. And again, I won't go through the whole thing in detail, but I'll pick out a few points. Firstly, as I've mentioned in the earlier report, it's crucial that behind the scenes the system works better than it does now. We've been working really hard with operators on this, but we're still only seeing around 90% accuracy and availability, which is poor considering that every bus has the equipment to be able to present it. So for us, that's the first thing to fix. That's the first thing for us to deal with, that's the first area to address. Next, we need to decide how we present information in future. It's clear we spent a lot of money, continue to do so, on introducing and maintaining what is actually a limited set of information screens at some bus stops. We need a lot of monitoring, a lot of management, and unfortunately suffer a lot of vandalism. So what we propose in the policy is that where we spend money in the future on screens, we do so where the assets can be protected at staff bus stations, but also where there's a high footfall, so they're more useful to more people, and where they can perform an additional function which reduces pressure on bus station staff in terms of answering potential queries which could potentially be self-served. But other stops will focus on using others' hardware to deliver real-time information. When screens were first deployed at bus stops, there was very little smartphone uses in the city region. That's now completely changed. Smartphones are widespread and can deliver better and more personalised information. We have the advantage that people buy and upgrade them themselves. And so what we need to do is focus on making that kind of transaction a little bit easier. Next, we'll be looking at other alternatives for presenting information at bus stops. So one option is using digital advertising screens at bus shelters. We had some initial dialogue with our shelter provider on the possibility of this. And again, that has the advantage of it being someone else who's providing the hardware and maintaining it for you. And then lastly, it's really important that we use the data in the system to better evidence the performance of the network and coming back onto punctuality and reliability, give us the information